Hey guys, welcome to another A-level physics video. And this time the paper we are doing is May-June 2016 P52. And a student is investigating the acceleration of a trolley moving up an inclined plane as shown in figure 1.1. So yeah, I think you're getting the gist of it. This is probably something to do with the gravity topic. In AS, we did quite a lot about this, actually, did we not? In which there was upward movement and gravity was basically sort of hindering said movement. And when all of the KE was converted to GPE at the top, beyond that, movement was not possible. So, the student is investigating the relationship between the acceleration A of the trolley and the angle theta of the inclined plane when the force F is applied to the trolley. So you need to realize that theta probably will have something to do with what proportion of gravity is acting horizontally against the motion, and so will determine the amount of resistive force. Gotta love AS. Right, and so this is the suggested relationship. G is obviously the acceleration of free fall, M is the mass of the trolley, and K is some constant. Need to design a laboratory experiment to test the relationship between A and theta, and you need to explain how your results could be used to determine a value for K. You should draw a diagram on page 3 showing the arrangement of your equipment and pay attention to procedure, measurements, variable control, data analysis, and safety precautions. So this is interesting. As I said, when you're reading through this, number one, be careful. Number two, draw links with all of the subject content you're aware of. You're gonna get a better understanding of it this way. With your limited knowledge of physics, you gotta make use of all that you do know and make useful links. So, how many variables can you identify? Well, there's obviously the mass of the trolley. There is obviously the acceleration of the trolley, there is obviously gravitational acceleration, theta of the inclined plane, K and force. And what you want to investigate is the relationship between A and theta. So one of them has to be the independent variable and the other dependent, and all others need to be kept constant. Returning to the question, so mass of the trolley can be something you need to keep constant. The initial force on the trolley is something that needs to be a constant. That's about it. G is most likely already a constant. So because you already have an idea of what A is going to be dependent on, A is going to be dependent on the resultant force and the mass. The mass is something we've already standardized. We're going to use a weighing balance to measure the mass of the vehicle and use the same vehicle each time, so the mass is going to be the same. So the second point is the resultant force, and that is going to be the difference between F, the one we exerted in the forward direction, and we're just going to have a standard value. I'm going to talk about how we're going to give it a constant value each time, and the backward resistive force, right? So the overall resistant force is going to be different, and the backward resistant force is basically due to the horizontal vector of gravity and the value of the horizontal vector is going to be dependent on theta, because mg is a constant. Theta is the only thing that is changing. So this is the theoretics, all right? I just want you to be in the game. And if some of you need a bit of heads up as to where this is coming from, this is from AS Physics. And we've read all about this in accelerated motion, etc. In dynamics, there is a bit of this as well to get your AS cleared up. So I believe that we are done with variables. So diagrammatic, there is a diagram aspect of it. You want to show the inclined plane. Obviously, the inclined plane is unlikely to be in thin air. Right, so you can, in my opinion, what you can do is you can do this to represent the surface. This is the inclined plane, and these are a pile of books you have used to raise them by different amounts. You're gonna have to label stuff up. Right, so how do you make a theta? You're gonna have to use a protractor. An easy way would be if you measure this distance with a ruler. Right, this is perpendicular and this is base. And you know, tan theta is equal to P over B. You can use that to figure out the value of theta. In my opinion, this is a great way to do it. Right? So, that's great. Now you're gonna vary theta in this manner, but the question is, how on earth are you gonna get the value of A? A is acceleration, isn't it? There's one way you can do that. You can have a light gate over here. And you can have a light gate over here. Oh, my apologies. So this is one way of doing this. And, oh my god. And when it passes the first, you know, the first part of it, the timer is going to start, and when it completely exits it, the timer is going to stop. There will be a value of t, which will be the difference between t1 and t2, and all of this will be computed, and you will be able to figure out in v initial by, you know, taking the distance between the times and, you know, dividing the length of the chord by it. And you're going to repeat this over here. So the t1, the moment it entered, and I guess t3, the moment it entered. You take the difference between them, you take the difference between the velocities, and you divide the difference in the velocities by the differences in the time it entered, and the time it entered this one. Right? You're gonna get the acceleration. This is one way of using light gates to get the value of the acceleration. Alright? And keep mass constant. Keep the friction constant. Actually, you can't keep the friction constant, but you can make sure that the inclined plane is clean and dry, right? And you can make try to ensure as much as you can that the chord follows the same path. And what about force? Well, one way would be to use this another inclined plane with a constant theta, and you would and the distance between them would also be a constant and hopefully a small value, and a marked point from which you drop the vehicle each time such that the force is likely going to be the same. That is one way of doing it, because the force is likely going to be the same. Another way, you often use spring-loaded devices for this, but doesn't seem like a good idea in this case. Right? So, any other ideas about? Well, the first one is a bit tricky in my opinion, but I think this is the best we can do with our level of knowledge, our level of expertise. So, the independent variable is the acceleration of the trolley. My apologies, the independent variable is the value of theta, and the dependent variable is the acceleration of the trolley. Constant variables are the mass of the trolley, the initial force F, the friction between the wheels of the cart and the inclined plane, as well as the value of G. Right? The theta between the horizontal surface and the inclined plane can be changed by using a different number of bucks to support the inclined plane. Right? And the value of theta can be measured. How so? The value of theta can be measured by measuring distance B and distance B, and theta will be tan minus 1 B over B. Tan theta is equal to, just wanted to show you how I did that. So theta is equal to tan minus 1, that is the tan inverse, is equal to P over B. And you're going to use a meter rule to measure these. And you have to be really careful when you do this. So you're going to get the value of theta, right? And how are you going to change? My apologies. And how are you going to measure A? Before that, there should be an inclined plane with a constant incline a set distance away, right? And with a known value of theta, right? And with a marked distance. And there should be two light gates, one just at the beginning and one at the end. The vehicle should be dropped from that fixed point with its rear end positioned at that point and then allowed to fall. When it goes through the first light gate, the timer is going to start and register a value of T1 and stop registering a value of T2 when the other end passes through it. Then it will reach the second light gate. The timer is going to start, register time T3 when the front part enters and stop registering a time T4 when the rear end passes. Velocity at A and B can be calculated by dividing the length of the card by the difference between T1 and T2. And T3 and T4 respectively. And to calculate the acceleration, you basically take the difference between the velocities at A and B and divide it by the difference between T1 and T2. That is how you're going to find the value of the acceleration. But what about the rest of it? To get the mass, you would simply weigh the cart. And the value of the force can be standardized by the use of a incline of standard theta, a set distance away. But how do you figure out the value of F? F is basically what? What is F basically? You may figure out the value of acceleration of the horizontal acceleration using light gates. And same as A, you will get the value of A. And you're going to get F by multiplying that by M. And you get the value of F. Although, unfortunately, there would indeed be some friction, but we can use a friction compensation track to minimize it or something, but that won't really work, unfortunately. So the best you can do is to use as clean or dry a surface as you possibly can. As for force, the use of a force loaded spring over here can also work, but I find this to be the more easier method. Data analysis. So what are the stuff you wanna, it's A and F, right? So A was, not A and F, my apologies, A and theta. A is the dependent variable, right? So it should be on the y-axis. So we want M to not be over there because y is alone in the straight line equation. F minus mg sine theta plus k over m, right? So this is why, and this is a whole lot of a mess. So f over m minus mg sine theta over m plus k over m. So a whole lot of complication here. So we can like sum these up. So this is like the c-intercept f plus k over m. Minus mg sine theta over m. This cancels out, so we are left with minus g sine theta. So if we plot sine theta on the x-axis and a on the y-axis, and we get a straight line with negative gradient, then the relationship is probably valid. So we need to determine a value for k. So apparently f plus k over m is equal to the y-intercept. We can find that from the graph. We know m and we know f, so it's c into m over f is equal to k. So what sort of precautions should you take? Trolley might fall down the surface, so the use of a sand tray could work out, but honestly it could like go over the surface, so we could have a sand tray over here. So let's see how well we did. Let's take a look at the marking scheme. Theta is the independent variable and A is the dependent. Keep F constant. Inclined plane with labeled support, not if a ruler used as the inclined plane or as a vertical support. method to measure angle, use a protractor to measure theta, or use a ruler to measure marked distances from which sine theta or theta may be determined. Method to measure a time or velocity to determine. Example, measure the time using a stopwatch, light gate connected to a timer, motion sensor connected to a time display, use of a balance to measure the trolley, of A against sine theta, and does not pass through the origin. K is equal to F minus M into sine theta. This doesn't make a lot of sense. We'll take a look at this. Maybe I made a mistake. Keep mass of trolley constant, use the same trolley. Sine theta. Proper distance determine length of slope. Length of card for light gate method. A for measurements taken appropriately with A as the subject. See, if you were using the other method and you wanted to determine what A was, you could use S is equal to 1 by 2 AT square for the other slope, which we were using to give a value of F. Measurement of F for a valid method. Taking reading from a Newton meter or from stretched elastic spring from extension. Allow falling weight. Example, F is equal to mg. Use a constant extension to produce a constant force. Not relevant because we didn't use this method. Inclined plane is the same height each side of the plane or spirit level across plane. Ensure F is parallel or it is falling. So let's see. F plus k over m minus g sine theta. Interesting. F plus k over m minus. I think I messed it over here because there was this similar problem in the other one, but mostly correct. Safe precaution linking to falling mass. Something I missed. Repetition is something I also missed. This is irrelevant to us, just as this one is relevant though. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm getting full marks, but I think I made a few mistakes. Probably it would be 13 or 14. This is important. Theta is the independent variable, keep F constant, label support, angle to determine A, measure the time using a stopwatch, use a balance to measure the mass of the trolley. This one doesn't really make a lot of sense. Why is it F minus M into Y intercept? If F plus K over M is equal to C, then it should be MC minus K, right? As in mass into the Y intercept. Minus F. And the reason why this has been reverse is because there should be a minus over here, and the same problem actually arose behind. I've made some sort of a mistake over here. Yes, this minus actually applies to both of these, and this made life hell of a lot of problem. It cost us two marks actually, and something, the sort of mistake you can make as well, which is why I'm saying please be careful about mistakes like this. After a break, let's take a look at the examiner report. So taking a look at the examiner report, in question 1, candidates did not always describe the method in the necessary detail. The method said candidates described to determine the acceleration often did not have enough detail and did not mention the appropriate measurements. Now the book I talked about actually has a really great description of how you can use all of those acceleration and those light gates to figure out the acceleration. I guess those would be in the accelerated motion chapter, which is chapter number 2, page 14. Don't have it, check out the ebook on GC guide. It's really great, and they've explained how to use measurements of light gates to find the acceleration. Using one light gate and using multiple. The one light gate one is pretty good too. So there is a card with two humps. Computer records the time for the first interrupt section of the card, that is the first hump, to pass through the light beam of the light gate. Given the length of the interrupt, it can work out the trolley's initial velocity u, and this is repeated for the second interrupt to give final velocity v. The computer also records the time interval t3 minus t1 between these two velocity measurements. Now it can calculate the acceleration as shown. So u is equal to l1, which is the length of the first section of the interrupt card, divided by t2 minus t1, and v is equal to l2 over t4 minus t3. Where L2 is the length of the second section of the interrupt card, and A is V minus U over T3 minus T1. And this calculation only gives an approximate value for A, because U and V are average speeds over a period of time. And for an accurate answer, we would need to know the speeds at T1 and T3. Unfortunately, that is really difficult at this level to find. Sometimes two light gates are used with a card of length L. The computer can still record the times as shown above and calculate the acceleration in the same way. Well, a motion sensor can also be used, right? And it's a bit more, you know, better at it, because it would be making a graph of displacement against time, and you can find the velocity at a moment by drawing a gradient. So that is something you can do. In some answers, there was a lot of irrelevant writing, and it is advisable that candidates should think carefully about the experiment following the points given on the question paper and to imagine how they would perform the experiment in an actual lab. Candidates were required to investigate the relationship between A and angle theta. When a force F is applied, most gained credit for stating that theta was independent, A was dependent, for stating that F needed to be kept a constant, and the mass of the trolley should also be the same. 4 marks available for the method of data collection. Correctly labeled diagram, inclined plane, how it was supported, and how the angle could be changed. Many rear supports that would not have made the inclined plane stable. Often a number of distances were marked on the diagram, but the start and end points were vague. The third was given for describing a suitable method to determine the acceleration, and candidates need to explain how they would measure a suitable time interval. Additional detailed marks were available for how an appropriate distance could be measured and for giving an appropriate equation to determine acceleration. Okay, you could use s is equal to 1 by 2 at square. Here you would have used horizontal displacement, the time taken between two points. That is something you could do. You could also use v square minus u square is equal to as, where s would have been horizontal displacement, a would have been horizontal acceleration, v would have been horizontal final velocity, right? But you would also have needed to know v would have been zero, obviously, and u on the other hand could have been calculated using a light gate or something. So loads of methods you can use. The one I described is perfectly fine, but if you do not have light gates or wanted a more mathematical approach to it, these would have worked out pretty great. If we were using s is equal to 1 by 2 at square plus ut, it would have been an interesting, then you would have say this would have been 1, this would have been second point, and you would have to clearly mention this on the diagram as being sh. And you would need a stopwatch. You would start it with the trolley. Maybe a good idea would be to have it over here. Passes this point, the front of it, and when the front of it passes over that, you would have stopped it because you would have needed to know the value of t. So s is equal to 1 by 2 at square plus ut. This may not actually work, unfortunately, because u is initial speed. And while you can indeed know what the initial speed is, if, for example, in addition to starting the stopwatch over here, you would have a light gate that would measure the initial speed, but hell of a lot of complication for nothing. There would have been v square minus u square is equal to 2as, right? This would have been interesting because sh would then have been the distance it could cover before it would start falling back. A bit difficult because you'd need a way to somehow mark that. Maybe some sort of a paint, so whatever distance it moved, it would disturb the paint. So you would know afterwards what sh was. So as for v, it would have obviously been zero, final speed. You would have needed a light gate to figure that out, complications. There's also, so I believe my way of doing it with two light gates, finding v at one point, v at the other point, and the total time interval, and using that to figure out the acceleration was pretty convenient and not bringing in unnecessary maths, unnecessary complication. When you can do it the easy way, why go for the hard one? You should know how to do that, because sometimes not using the one method is impossible for whatever reason. How they would measure a suitable time interval, detail how an appropriate distance could be measured, and for giving an appropriate equation to determine acceleration. Many candidates simply stated the definition, which was not necessarily relevant to the method they had suggested. Many candidates suggested data logging procedures, which I did. Clear explanations are needed for the required measurements. For example, if a piece of cord is being used to interrupt a light beam, then this length of cord needs to be measured with a ruler. The final mark in this section was for the method of obtaining the mass of the trolley, which would be needed to determine k. Ease of balance, but not scales. Scale is not the appropriate way to call that. Now, one thing I found that while I suggested the inclined plane method, perhaps it would have been better to use a loaded spring launcher. So So in my opinion, the use of a loaded spring launcher at this point would be a good idea. And then the same method as before with two light gates connected to data logging device. And really be really careful with complex equations when you're making something the subject. A bit of mistake will cost you a lot. And this is it. Hopefully you found this to be helpful. Thank you.